Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Alice Sampson, Assistant Professor with Nalsa University of Law. This paper is African and Caribbean Writing, and in the current module, we will be looking at Errol John's Moon on a Rainbow Shawl. Before we begin, let me give you an overview of the module. In this lesson, through a reading of Moon on the Rainbow Shawl, we will introduce the reader to the life and work of the Caribbean playwright Errol John. The lesson introduces the reader to various aspects of the play, including its plot and main characters. It also contextualizes the play in the discussions of situations in the Trinidad. Introduction to Moon on a Rainbow Shawl. This is a three-act play which was published in 1957. The play was written by Trinidadian actor-playwright Errol John. It is often considered as a groundbreaking play to have emerged out of the Caribbean mind. It was staged several times in England and is without doubt the most successful play which is authored by a black man. In 1957, it was premiered on the Royal Court Theatre and immediately hailed as a great play. The play won Errol John instant fame and several awards, including the prestigious Observer's Prize for the Best New Playwright in 1957. He also won the Guggenheim Fellowship in 1958. In 1958, the play's radio adaptation, titled Small Island Moon, was broadcast on the BBC. In 1962, an American version of the play was released and was staged in New York City. Set in the city of the Port of Spain, the capital of the small island nation of Trinidad and Tobago, the play opens on a hot, late evening in the yard of two dilapidated buildings. The play Moon on a Rainbow Shawl depicts the struggle of a man to escape an impoverished Port of Spain slum. The play was later performed in such diverse locations as Australia, Iceland, Hungary, and Argentina. It has been prescribed in several courses in various countries in the Caribbean region. Since its inception, the play has been staged several times in various spaces across the world. The play's popularity and relevance have outlived its author. It has won new fans among the current generation of theatre lovers. Moon on a Rainbow Shawl contains a tragicomic plot, and the action takes place in the post-war setting of Old Mac's Yard in Port of Spain, Trinidad. It focuses on the complex relationship between the members of the Adams family, the struggle of tram driver Ephraim, who dreams of moving to England to escape the impoverished slums, and the dreams of Rosa. The Second World War has just ended and the soldiers are returning home. The play also throws light on the socio-economic conditions of the island. The cramped claustrophobia of the location and the heightened tension recall the simmering kitchen sink melodrama of various American playwrights, including Tennessee Williams and Arthur Miller. Bringing to life a multitude of stories featuring a diverse range of characters, sounds, including calypso, children's rhyme, and everyday cacophony, the play is a vibrant but harsh evocation of the hardship of poverty, faded dreams, and regret in post-war Trinidadian society. Introduction to Errol John. Errol John was born in Port of Spain on 20th of December 1924. He was homeschooled and began to work as an artist and a journalist. However, he found his true calling as an actor and an artist and decided to pursue a career in theatre. He joined Whitehall Theatre Group in Trinidad. Post the Second World War, he intended to migrate to England, and in 1951, he arrived in London. In London, he continued to work as an actor and acted in several productions, including Salome 1954 and The Member of the Wedding. This was authored by Carson McMullers and was staged at the Royal Court Theatre. The production was directed by Tony Richardson. He was noted for his performance of Shakespeare's characters and acted in The Merchant of Venice, Measure for Measure, and Othello. He also won a lot of critical acclaim for these roles and some of the roles in several small films, including The African Queen, The Heart of the Matter, The Emperor Jones, Simba, Nun's Story, and Guns at Batasi. He found indirect employment with the BBC and gained a major role in the series A Man from the Sun, No Hiding Place, and a five-part series Rainbow City. Errol's debut as a playwright was inauspicious. His first play, The Tout, which was written in Trinidad, was very unsuccessful. His second play, Moon on a Rainbow Shawl, achieved iconic status as a classic of Caribbean theatre. Post the success of Moon on a Rainbow Shawl, Errol wrote Force Majeure, The Dispossessed and Hasta Luego, three screenplays. He also wrote the screenplay for Telly Club and Dawn and The Exiles. The Exiles was a part of the Wednesday play series, which was produced by BBC. In 1960s, as Moon on a Rainbow Shawl became popular in the United States, Errol sought to work in Hollywood. However, he was unsuccessful as a movie star and was limited to a few minor roles in films, including Assault on a Queen and Buck and Preacher. He returned to England in 1970 and settled in Camden, London. He passed away on July 10, 1988 in London. Posthumously, the government of Trinidad and Tobago honored him with the Chaconia Medal for Drama. Action in Moon on the Rainbow Shawl. The play was divided into three acts, which was further divided into two scenes each. The setting of the play is within two dilapidated buildings in downtown Port of Spain, and the action takes place within 3 days. In the opening scene, titled The Moon Rise, or the opening act of the play, Ephraim, sometimes called F, is returning from work as a trolley bus driver. The night is hot and the full moon is up in the sky. Ephraim briefly talks to Ketch, the local calypso artist, as he approaches the two dilapidated buildings. He splashes water on his face at the public tap and stops to converse with Esther Adams. Esther's parents, Charlie Adams and Sophia Adams, have left her at home to take care of her newborn brother. Esther is very intelligent and a studious girl who has just won a scholarship to attend a better school. Ephraim and Esther discuss how her family cannot afford to send her to high school. The baby cries and Ephraim says, "Dream your dreams, little man, dream your dreams." Though Ephraim is secretly envious of Esther's youth and opportunity, she has to make a better life for herself than he has, and he encourages her. He tells her that one of these nights he will take Esther and Rosa to the concert. He urges Esther to one night sometimes reach up, touch that moon before moving to his room. Sophia arrives and chastises her daughter for staying outdoors late into night. Rosa, who is the girlfriend of Ephraim, arrives home. She is accompanied by old Mac, who is both her employer and landlord. Old Mac drops to his knees and pleads Rosa to accept his gifts. As old Mac leaves Rosa, Sophia catches up with Rosa. She warns him against indulging old Mac. She reminds Rosa that she has to speak to Ephraim. Rosa goes to Ephraim's room. Ephraim asks her to leave his room. He is pensive and is smoking a cigarette. In the second scene of Act 1, titled Next Morning, Esther wants to go out and play with her friends. Sophia refuses Esther the permission to go out and reminds her that they are a poor household without any help. Rosa comes home and informs Sophia that some money has been stolen from Old Mac's cafe. Sophia chuckles on hearing about Old Mac's misfortune and adds, "Thief from thief, child does not make Jehovah laugh, and I is the only mere mortal. The way he is robbing us here with the rent on these nasty little rooms, serve him blasted right." Rosa looks out for Ephraim, but he's avoiding her. Rosa is summoned back to the cafe. Ephraim walks out of his room and speaks to Sophia. The iceman passes by and Ephraim explains that the iceman is so warm, he doesn't know. He doesn't know, but the only ice I feel for now is snow. Sophia feels that Ephraim is up to something, but is not able to figure out his schemes. Prince, a loud entrepreneur who is smitten by Mavis, enters the building. Mavis is a prostitute who entertains the soldiers. Sophia and Mavis do not get along with each other. Charlie Adams, the always drunk former cricketer and Sophia's husband, arrives. He is suffering from a hangover and describes the reception which he attended last night to welcome home the island's World War II troops. As he speaks of heroes, Sophia scornfully inquires if Charlie had not felt shame. Charlie avoids an argument and moves to Ephraim's room. Sophia continues to speak to Ephraim and tell him about what she fears. She is worried about the new school that Rosa has to go to. She tells Ephraim that Charlie was a world-class cricketer many years ago. As Ephraim blames the social and political conditions in Trinidad, Sophia disagrees. She reminds him that many cricketers on the island have succeeded without any special privileges. Ephraim confesses that this Trinidad has nothing for me, nothing I want. Sophia is stunned and asks him about his relationship with Rosa. Ephraim hints at having a plan and he leaves a message with Sophia that he will maybe see Rosa tonight. She's supposed to attend a party for a fellow that's going away from the island. When Sophia asks why he is going, Ephraim replies, "I'll ask him when I see him." In response, Sophia says, "Run, boys, run. I wish I could do a little running myself. They'd search hell to find me." Rosa returns from the cafe and wants to talk to Charlie. However, the conversation never happens. That evening, Rosa tries to seduce Ephraim, but he will not sleep with her. In the opening scene of Act 2, it is late in the night. Mavis is bringing home a soldier. She has a verbal confrontation with Sophia. The baby cries and Sophia explains to the Lord, "Ye hear the baby, God, ye hear him. No rest for me tonight. Grant me patience, I'm asking ye. Save me from sinning my soul." Rosa visits Ephraim's room. She tries to sleep next to him. He's not interested in it. They are sleeping on her rainbow shawl. Rosa informs Ephraim that Charlie has stolen the money from the cafe. She says that she has seen his hat on the floor of the shop. She also tells Ephraim that she has disclosed the same to the police and fears that they will arrest Charlie. Ephraim is angry and states that she is endangering the Adams family when the wealthy, stingy old Max could well afford to lose the money stolen. He accuses her of having a soft corner for old Mac and states she's accepting and wearing his expensive gifts. Ephraim tells her that there is nothing between them and he's leaving for Liverpool the following day. He shows her the tickets, his savings and the passport. Rosa pleads with him and asks him to stay back. She reveals that she's pregnant with his child, which does not sway his decision to leave. She's furious and leaves the room. The action in scene 2 takes place the next morning. Sophia is urging Charlie to complete preparing the cricket bats. Prince comes to meet Mavis and is disturbed by the fact that she spent the night with a soldier. He is heartbroken as he realizes that Mavis is only a prostitute. She accidentally hits Mavis and injures her. Prince and Mavis reconcile and announce their wedding. Old Mac comes to the yard and announces that he wants to report his employee Stephen to the police. Charlie, fearful that old Mac's employee Stephen is going to be arrested for his crime, confides to Sophia that he robbed the cafe. As Sophia suggests that they have Rosa speak to old Mac and return the money, Ephraim overhears the conversation. He demands that he return the money. Meanwhile, the police arrive and arrest Charlie. In the first scene of Act 3, Ephraim goes to Prince, who is drinking beer, and borrows a cigarette. Mavis informs them that Sophia has gone to meet old Mac to borrow money and bail Charlie out. Ephraim is tipsy and staggers back to his room. Esther, oblivious of her dad's arrest, arrives home. Sophia comes home and finds young Murray, a young batsman, waiting for her. Murray informs her that the boys want Charlie to coach the cricket team before he leaves. Sophia tells Esther about her dad's arrest. Esther blames Sophia and tells her that she is the reason for Charlie's decline. She reminds her mother that she is always pushing him and making him feel shame in front of all kinds of people. As she yells and runs out into the yard, Ephraim leaves for his last trolley shift. Rosa comes back to the yard and speaks to Sophia. She says that Charlie's matter has moved out of old Mac's hands. Sophia asks Rosa to speak to Ephraim and convince him. Rosa is adamant and retorts that a wedding ring is too cheap to have to kiss a man's foot for. In the last scene of the play, a glamorously dressed Mavis and Prince are going out to a nightclub. Ephraim is packing his stuff and Sophia is searching for Esther. Sophia confronts Ephraim and tries to convince him to stay back. He offers $10 bills to bail out Charlie. She refuses the money and pleads him not to abandon a pregnant Rosa. She reminds him that it was he who first seduced Rosa. Ephraim retorts back and argues that Rosa liked sleeping with him. He further adds that the baby born, it live, it dead, it make no damn difference to me. A distraught Sophia slaps him. Ephraim leaves the yard in a taxi and Rosa comes out running into the yard calling for Ephraim. Sophia tries to comfort Rosa and says that she will support her. But her words of support are interrupted by the sound of old Mac calling for Rosa from Rosa's room. The play ends with Esther's return, warmly calling for her mother. Now let's look at the sounds in Moon on Rainbow Shawl. Errol John borrows several sounds from everyday life to lend credence to the play's settings. The action in the first scene of Act 1 opens with the steel drum, which is playing a military beat. The sound indicates that there is a military presence on the island. The calypso singer's voice and practices are also heard. The calypso indicates that the action is taking place in West Indies. The baby's cry comes up frequently throughout the play and it lends domesticity to the play. In scene 2, Esther wants to go out and play. The audience hear children say, "You can't catch me though, you can't catch me though, I can't catch her, I can't catch her, I caught her." The audience realize that kids in the building are out playing. The use of the Creole informs the reader or audience that the play is set in West Indies and the action is taking place amidst a domestic setting. The kid's sounds hinder Rosa from having a conversation with Charlie. As she intends to question Charlie, the kids chant, I caught her, distract her and affect the scope of her actions. The other children's rhymes used include the play 1, 2, 3, mother catch a flea, flea die, mother cry, 1, 2, 3, you to catch, you to catch. Likewise, the conversation between Sophia and Ephraim is also affected by the sound of an iceman selling his wares in a sing-song manner. Thus, the voices from outside give the reader the feeling that something is amiss in the characters. The first scene of Act 2, the action begins with the blowing of wind, hooting of an owl, and the roof squeaks and shudders in the wind. The sound lends an ominous air to the setting. The baby's cry rents the air, forcing Sophia to pray. You hear the baby, God, you hear him. No rest for me tonight. Grant me patience, I am asking you. Save me from sinning my soul. The hoot of the owl is repeated, and even as Rosa informs Ephraim, that sound scares her, Ephraim mimics the bird closely. Rosa is already suspicious of Ephraim's intentions. As Ephraim reveals his intentions of abandoning Rosa and the baby, the calypso brown-skinned girl is heard. The calypso taunts her with the words, brown-skinned girl, stay home and mind baby. Brown-skinned girl, stay home and mind baby. I am gaining away in a sailing boat. And if I don't come back, throw away the damn baby. In the scene 2, as Mavis and Prince make up, the sound of wedding is heard. The sound accentuates the effect of Mavis's words. Always get the ring first, then get the baby. In the scene out of Act 3, the sound of rain and thunder are heard. The rain and thunder add solemnity to the departure of Ephraim. As Ephraim is packing his stuff, he turns on the radio. Frank Sinatra's Polka Dots and Moonbeams is being played in the background. The taxi is around the corner and honks impatiently. The sound of the horn is loud and jarring and forces Rosa out of her room. It is the sound of a goodbye and also harkens the end of an unequal relationship. Let's now look at the themes in Moon on a Rainbow Shawl. The themes in Moon on a Rainbow Shawl, now regarded as a canonical work of black theatre, are still relevant today. Its depictions of immigration, the struggles faced by the African diaspora, and the sacrifices and aspirations of a post-war community living in poverty are resonant today. The story describes the depths into which circumstances can force a human being to stoop down. The play sheds light on the unequal relation between men and women. All the men in the play are selfish and weak. Old Mac is lecherous and stingy pervert who leaves no opportunity unused to seduce Rosa. Prince is so smitten by Mavis, the prostitute, that he does not consider the evidence of her infidelity. When he sees the evidence, he hurts her. When Mavis threatens him with the police, Prince is scared easily and promises marriage. Charlie is an old fool who has wasted his life and steals money to finance his addictions. Ephraim is young and hardworking but is unethical. He has seduced Rosa, won her trust and has made her pregnant. He has no qualms in abandoning her. The women in the play, on the other hand, are strong and loving. Barring Mavis, Sophia, Rosa and even the teenage Esther are diligent and ethical. They support their men despite the flaws. They stick to the place and want to fight. The difference between men and women in the play is very stark. The second theme that is recurrent is the theme that all the characters have given up hope of making a good life in Trinidad. They have either resigned themselves to fate or seek to exploit others to make a living. Ephraim seeks to escape the hopeless situation in the island by migrating to England. Charlie has resigned to the hopeless state and takes refuge in drink. Old Mac wants to maximize his profit out of the hopeless state on the island. Mavis is making a living by catering to rich soldiers. Sophia and Rosa are also aware of the dim prospects that are available to them, but they decide to stay on. The decision to stay behind and continue is not a testimony of their hope that the things will turn around, but is indicative of the state of hopelessness. They are not sure of the prospects outside the island. Only Esther, who is very young and intelligent, has hope. The play also comments on how global politics can shape the political economy of small places. The end of the Second World War has affected the life on the island. As the American troops leave the island, business goes down, jobs are cut, and many Trinidadians who are otherwise employed find themselves jobless. The Six-Year War, the gradual decline of colonial power, and the withdrawal of the American troops have contributed to inflation, unemployment, and lawlessness on the island. Trinidad, which the US deems is located in its own backyard, does not play a significant role in the World War. It is geographically removed from Europe, which was the main theater of the war. However, it felt the ramifications of the war quite acutely. The play states that the conventions and the traditions of local populations have been altered permanently, and the people on the island are deeply affected. They are anxious and many of them display psychotic conditions. Ephraim's inexplicable urge to migrate, Esther's shrieks, Prince's infatuation for Rosa are all indicative that the local population is severely traumatized by the end of the war. Let's look at some of the major characters in Moon on the Rainbow Shawl. Ephraim, he works with the tram department. He's a protagonist and is a protagonist of the play, and he feels trapped in a Trinidadian society where opportunity and upward mobility are scarce. He's also aware that the rich abuse the poor. He demands more from life. He's aware of the political situation on the island. He's sympathetic to the underdog and is a soft corner for Charlie and Sophia. He sympathizes with Charlie and wishes the best for Esther. He offers money to Sophia and volunteers to intercede with old Mac on behalf of Charlie. However, he is good only when issues do not affect his own interests. He is selfish and conceited. He has no qualms in abandoning people and does not want to take responsibility for his actions. He boasts that he has boarded her old grandmother in a poor house to die alone. Forsakes Rosa to her fate and is unmindful of her being pregnant. He's sexist and chauvinist even at times when he's helpful to others. Sophia Adams, though physically and emotionally exhausted, she's a spirited woman. She's the wife of Charlie Adams and the mother of Esther. She also has a newborn son, and she's fond of Ephraim and Rosa and detests Mavis. She cares fiercely for Esther's future, hence she's tough on Esther. She's a good mother and asks Rosa to convince Ephraim to stay back. Rosa is a young girl. She is orphaned and was raised by nuns. She owns a rainbow shawl. As she has come to stay in the yard, Ephraim befriends her. She loves Ephraim and allows him to seduce her. She is pregnant with his child. However, she is not able to convince him to stay back with her. She is being wooed by her employer, old Mac. Though he supplies her with costly gifts, Rosa does not reciprocate his affections. Towards the end of the play, when she realizes that she has been duped by Ephraim, she consents to remain with old Max so that her child can have a father. The biggest tragedy in the play is that Rosa has become corrupted and has lost her innocence. Old Mac is a 65-year-old wealthy, stingy man who owns the yard and the shacks that the Adams, Ephraims, Rosa and Mavis live in. He also owns a cafe where Rosa works. As Sophia says, he's a man never to be generous, yet he generously showers costly gifts on Rosa when he's infatuated with her. He's loathed by his tenants and his employees. Towards the end of the play, Rosa has no option but to stay back with old Mac, hence he gets what he wants. Esther Adams is the eldest child of Sophia and Charlie Adams. She is young, bright and a motivated girl. She presents a positive future for Trinidad. She helps her mother, domestic chores, takes care of her brother and is pleasant to her neighbors. She is liked by everyone in the yard and she helps Sophia realize that her attitude towards Charlie has ruined her. The final stage directions note that Esther calls for a mother should give the impression that the future could still be hers. Charlie Adams is a drunkard who performs odd jobs. He's the husband of Sophia and father of Esther. Formerly, he was a cricketer of international repute. However, his dreams are shattered as he's sidelined by the white men who run the cricket boards. He's sidelined from cricket as he voiced his opinions against institutional racism, which was embedded in West Indian cricket boards. He's extremely supportive of his daughter and her efforts, and which is seen by his actions in the play. He wants a bright and prosperous future for Esther. He's scared of his wife, however, and his addiction to drinking causes his ruin and he's forced to steal money from old Mac. When old Mac suspects Stephen for robbing his cafe, Charlie feels bad for Stephen and speaks up to own up his own crime. Mavis is a beautiful young lady who caters to the physical desires of the American soldiers and the local elite. She lives in the same yard and is detested by Sophia. She's more intelligent than either Rosa or Sophia. Towards the end of the play, she's engaged to the rich local entrepreneur Prince. She comments that women should get their men to commit to marriage before first making babies. She admires Ephraim. However, she says she would, unlike Rosa, not have allowed him to use her and abandon her. Prince is a local black entrepreneur who is enamored by Mavis. He refuses to believe that Mavis is a prostitute and his antics offer comic relief to an otherwise serious play. To conclude, we have looked at Moon on a Rainbow Shawl in great detail. We have examined Errol John's life and works, the main characters in the play and the major themes within the play. For more information, look up the e-text. Thank you.